Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations.
Last December, Pope John Paul II repudiated the teachings of Father Hans Küng, a Swiss theologian of great prestige who teaches at the University of Tübingen in Germany. The practical effect on Father Küng is barely noticeable. He continues to teach theology, but the state university, under the terms of its concordat, cannot designate him as a Catholic, quote-unquote, theologian. The symbolic effect of the repudiation of Kung, along with that of Schillebeck in Holland, is enormous. It suggests a reorientation under the present Pope of the Vatican's attitude towards Orthodoxy. If Kung was not teaching Catholic theology in 1979, why was he tolerated in 1977 or 1967, for that matter? The Catholic world is divided on the question of the Pope's theological assertiveness, as we shall see. Michael Davies is a British writer, a convert to Catholicism at age 21, who has written a half dozen books on Christian and Catholic thought, including most recently an apologia pro Marcel Lefebvre, a defense, if that is exactly the word for it, of the controversial archbishop who defied Pope Paul VI by presiding over a seminary which clung to the Tridentine Mass displaced by Vatican II. Mr. Davies is a graduate of St. Mary's College in London and served in the British Army. His first book was Cranmer's Godly Order, and his upcoming book is called Pope Paul's New Mass. Father Joseph Champlin works at the Chancery at Syracuse, New York. He graduated from Phillips Academy at Andover, studied at Yale and Notre Dame, and was ordained after completing studies at St. Andrew's and St. Bernard's seminaries. He's written a dozen books. He writes a syndicated column, does a daily broadcast, and has served on the Bishop's Committee on the Liturgy and lectured on the liturgy at the Princeton Theological School. Our examiner, Dr. Malachi Martin, will be introduced in due course. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Davies whether the action of Pope Paul John is an implied rebuke to the inaction of Pope Paul.
Well, I suppose obviously it is an implied rebuke, because there are many demands that Pope Paul VI should condemn Hans Küng. In fact, the book I wrote before this one, it's one about the priesthood called The Order of Melchizedek. I had a chapter on Hans Küng showing that his theology is completely incompatible with Catholicism, documenting it all from his own books. And I said it was quite scandalous that he should be allowed to continue as an accredited teacher of Catholic theology while Archbishop Lefebvre was suspended. I'm very glad that that situation has been put right now. Obviously, what I'm hoping now is that the suspension will be lifted from Archbishop Lefebvre and everything will be back to normal.
Well, is it your judgment that that Pope Paul John is bringing the theological house back to order, or is in your judgment, is he up to something that's actually new?
Well, I think Pope John Paul, mm-hmm. His theology, I'd say, is virtually identical with Archbishop Lefebvre's. When he was over here last fall, you call it, don't you, in the autumn, mm-hmm. as we'd say, he took up every controversial issue within the American church, such as the ordination of women, contraception, abortion, every controversial issue there is, and he came out with a traditional answer on it. In the spring of last year, he came out with a book on the priesthood, which I was very pleased to see. It was all the theology in it was practically identical with the book which I'd written on the priesthood myself. He's now come out with a new letter on the Holy Eucharist, in which he reaffirms all the traditional Catholic teaching that the Mass is a sacrifice, our Lord is truly present, that the priest acts in what we call in persona Christi, in the person of Christ. He condemns practices which are pretty common in America, such as not wearing the proper vestments for Mass, using unauthorized readings. He comes out very strongly in favor of that only the priest should distribute Holy Communion, that extraordinary ministers of communion should only be used in the very rarely if it's needed, and also a practice that's quite common in America, which they call Eucharistic hospitality, allowing non-Catholics to receive communion. He said that that's the norms, the Vatican has norms for that, they should be adhered to rigidly. So I think most traditionalists are very encouraged by that. But where we would have our problem is our traditionalists like myself, our conflict with the Vatican is over matters like the form of the Mass.
Well, let's save that for a moment. Right. I'd like to ask Father Champlin whether the recitation you've just heard is one with which you are at odds, and do you think that the silencing of Kung is a word that's used, but it's used incorrectly because he's not silent, but the disciplinary measures taken there are justified objectively?
I really want to pass on that. I'd like to go back to what my friend had to say, because he kind of took a whole bunch of things in it, lumped them together, like Eucharistic ministers were really being reproved by the Holy Father or emphasizing the priest role. I think there were so many things brought together that it's more than I'd like to say. My first point I would like to pick up from what he said, it seemed to me that the Holy Father is dealing today with a situation, and you can't compare what he's doing today with what was done 2 years ago or 3 years ago and say, Pope Paul should have done that then because he's doing it now. I think there are different historical contexts, you know. Now, you said, is it justified or not?
Well, are you saying something more interesting than that 1980 is different from 1977?
Of course.
What?
Oh, I think that that's a historical context, just as the church was moving in an age in the 70s, there's always kind of an ebb and flow of culture and history between, say, an era of transcendence, maybe excessive era, atmosphere of the sacred, and needing to have a liturgy that's more involving the people. Same time, we go the other extreme of it becoming too much of a popular kind of liturgy, as Man in Common Wheel just wrote the other day. We've lost the sense of the transcendence. I think history has ebbs and flows, and I don't think you can judge a decision now from a decision 4 or 5 years ago. As far as a decision, I think the Holy Father is clearly just saying you can't say he's a Catholic theologian.
Yeah. Right. Now, do I understand you to say that this is a cultural perception rather than an analytical perception? Because I'm trying to understand is why this was a discovery made in 1979 about writings that are 20 years old, some of them. Or is that just bureaucratic sloth?
I don't think I have a good response to that. I guess I'd like to go back to the question of the Archbishop. You could say the same thing as I read your book, which I really found very interesting. Until I was asked to be on the program, I didn't have those details, and I found your book very interesting. But what I found very interesting was how the Holy Father was very patient, took a great deal of time before he finally made a decision with the Archbishop and brought it public. He tried to have a healing. I think the same thing could be applied to the matter of Hans Kung and...
Well, with Archbishop Lefebvre, the Pope had certain difficulties, surely, because after all, Archbishop Lefebvre was doing exactly the same thing that was done obligatorily for some 500 years, whereas Kung was going off in a direction that was clearly opposite the acknowledged deposit of the faith, wasn't it?
Well, I think it'd be hard to pin that much down, but the Archbishop was going very strongly against the express direction of the Holy Father, done first quietly, but then publicly, where he was said not to do this, and he clearly went against the Holy Father.
Yeah, but that was a disciplinary matter. But going against the Holy Father as a matter of discipline is one thing.
Mm-hmm.
preaching heresy is something else. Now, nobody's gotten around, have they, to saying that the Tridentine Mass is heretical?
No, no, the Archbishop's never been criticized for any of his doctrine. And as you say, Hung, I would agree with you that the situation hasn't changed. Kung's, for instance, his book on infallibility, Kung is an honest man, and he comes out with what he says, and he straightforward, in a straightforward manner, rejects the doctrine of papal infallibility. In his book, Why Priests, he says that the priesthood wasn't instituted by Christ, that there's no sacred character imprinted at the priesthood, the priest has no powers which ordinary people don't have, that in an emergency a layman or laywoman could preside at the Eucharist. All this is a straightforward contradiction of infallible papal teaching. And as you say, he wrote these books years ago. I think the difficulty with Pope Paul VI was he wasn't really willing to go against the spirit of the times. He started off this reform of Vatican II with great hopes. It was supposed to bring about a great renewal, for instance, a great renewal in the liturgy, and it's ended up with chaos. There was to be a renewal in religious life. And the United States, you've had 50,000 nuns have left their convents, which is a funny sort of renewal. You've had 10,000 priests have been laicized. His policy with the communist world, his Ostpolitik, that turned out to be a disaster. And it's very hard for a person in authority to face up to the fact publicly that everything he's been doing has turned out to be a disaster. And of course, I think Kung was a symbol of the what tradition is called the conciliar church, the Church of Vatican II, much admired by Protestants. As you know, his condemnation has evoked fury from liberal Catholics and from Protestants. Even the Church Times, a very conservative Anglican newspaper, they've compared the Pope to the Ayatollah of the West, and they've questioned whether there's any future in the ecumenical movement anymore.
What is your comment on that, Father?
I think the problem I have is that we're getting a lot of things kind of simply thrown out, that the reason why 15,000 nuns have left and priests have left are because of the changes of Vatican II or because of the new liturgy, or the Holy Father has, the Pope John Paul II is kind of reversing the trend. I think that's very simplistic. I mean, it's very difficult to explain why so many priests have left. My classmates, you know, why. One-third of my class has left the ministry after 25 years, or sisters. I mean, we've been through a cultural explosion in 10, 15 years. Have all different value systems. We've got future shock, a whole change of approach. And to say because we have a vernacular liturgy or mass facing the people or more participation, that that's the cause for that, the changes of Vatican II. I think the changes in the world happened before and during and after Vatican II, and to say it's because of liturgical changes we've had the lack of renewal in the church, I think that's a simplistic answer.
Well, it may be simplistic. you may reject a causative explanation. On the other hand, certainly that which was held forward as primarily justifying Vatican II didn't happen.
Well,
it was to be a great unifying, spiritualizing experience. Mm. And in fact, it caused widespread disaffection.
Well, the council caused widespread disaffection.
Well, I should say it was followed by. We've got this post hoc, propter hoc
again,
problem.
I don't think you can say that. The council basically called for a spiritual renewal and also an attempt to make the church adapted to the shifting conditions of the time.
Well, why don't we be very concrete?
Mm-hmm.
I am a practicing Roman Catholic. Fine. Who finds attendance at the new mass an aesthetic ordeal. And so, quite apart from the Vietnam War or Hugh Hefner or anything else,
yeah.
I find the attendance at mass less satisfying than it used to be, in part because I find what's going on in the altar expressing a kind of fascistic concern for me. They won't let me alone for 3 minutes.
Uh-huh.
I got to stand up when I was sitting down, I got to sit down when I was standing up. I got to embrace people. I got to listen to children who don't know how to keep a tune twanging away a guitar. All that kind of stuff I find distracting. I'm just one person reporting one individual's reaction. How do you cope with that?
So you like the old liturgy because the eye was able to pray and you weren't kind of impinged by a priest or other people. That kind of notion? The old liturgy gave you a sense of
it gave me a sense that the priest was there as a mediator between me and God, whereas it seems to me that the existing approach tends to be sort of crowd-oriented.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's the key thing right there.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the key thing that has tried to happen as a result of Vatican II. I think it's the key tension, and I think it's the key balance that has to be preserved. That the Vatican, before Vatican II, when I was ordained in 56, the Mass was very much of a mystery. I was a priest with my back to the people in Latin. There was silence in the congregation, except when the altar boy dropped the cruet on the marble and it broke, and he uttered a little word that was echoed throughout the church, began with us, and everybody laughed. That's the only participation we had, all right? We had an eye kind of worship. We had an angry celebrant. We had an eye worship, all right? The council then, going back to the best traditions of the early church, said it's both I and we together. It's a vertical worship, yes, but it's also a horizontal worship. Now, going from an I kind of worship, which you liked, where no one sort of impinged upon your worship and the priest was a mediator, but where these people were sort of not really clearly related to you in that worship.
Yeah.
To go from there to that.
Yeah, to the communitarian approach.
All right.
But after all, I don't remember that anyone then or even today discourages attending Mass even if you're the sole person in the church. That is to say, one isn't supposed to need a congregation in order fully to participate in the Mass, does one?
No, but the church be very clear that the preferred way is that it's communal, to bring out both dimensions.
Well, how do they find that out? Mr. Davis, how do they find that out? I know that you studied in this book and elsewhere the constitution of the liturgy. Is there anything in the liturgy, for instance, that tells the priest to face the people?
No, it's a point I'd like to bring up. Father says I've been bringing too many things up at one time, so I'd just like to perhaps bring one point for him to comment on. Now, Father is talking here as if the way Mass is celebrated in churches in America today has got something to do with Vatican II, but it's got absolutely nothing to do with the liturgy constitution whatsoever. There's a very well-known priest, you must have heard of Father Louis Bouyer, haven't you?
Yes.
Well, he wrote a book just after Vatican II called The Liturgy Revived, saying this was the culmination of the whole liturgical movement, what a great renewal and revival was going to come. A few years later, he wrote a book called The Decomposition of Catholicism, in which he said the reform as we now have it is a betrayal of Vatican II and the whole liturgical movement. Now, to come to the specific example I'd like Father to comment on, he said we're going back to the sound practices of the early church, such as Mass facing the people. Well, Mass has never been celebrated facing the people at any time at all in the history of the church and of the Protestant Reformation. So this isn't a... And it wasn't mentioned, there's not one word about it anywhere in Vatican II. There's no suggestion that Mass should be celebrated facing the people. It was just some priest probably thought that this is a sort of trendy idea to do. All the others started copying them. Then you hear all this talk about the great church of the poor, and they must have spent over the world thousands of millions of dollars smashing up beautiful altars.
Let's go back to the question of facing the people, all right? Because now we're getting into the church of the poor, changing around.
Yes.
Okay. So, even before Vatican II, there was always... the rubrics are very clear. The celebrant could face the walls of tradition. But it said if the priest faces versus populum, this is what he does. So it was always a possibility. And very interesting film strip that we always use with our parents and so on to give them the sense of the history of the liturgy, published by Alpha. Pretty clear documentation in those early days, even if we look at the basilicas, if you look at St. Peter's, those other churches, where is the position of the celebrant? The bishop is in the apse facing the people, the altar's facing the people. St. Peter's is facing the people. Pretty rich tradition.
Sorry, Father, but you're very confused there. You see, Mass has always been celebrated facing the east, in the churches of the Oriental churches and in the Western churches. There are a few basilicas, like St. Peter's in Rome, where the apse happens to be at the west end, so the altar was positioned so that the priests could celebrate Mass facing the east. During the more important parts
of St. Paul's
the,
outside the walls,
yes,
too?
Yes, those Roman, there was just a few Roman basilicas. During the essential parts of the Mass, the congregation would be on the aisle at each side, facing the east. They wouldn't be facing the priest. So the whole congregation would be facing the east. And all the historical and archaeological evidence, there's a Professor Cyril Vogel in a magazine called L'Église de Lorient. L'Église Syrienne, I think. It's about the Syrian church. And he's gone into this in very great detail. Louis Boyer has written a book on it. And it's absolutely incontrovertible that never at any time in the history of the church has Mass been celebrated facing the people till you came to the Protestant Reformation. And the eastward orientation, that denoted sacrifice. And they said a table is to have a meal upon. They made a table and replaced the eastward position with a position facing the congregation.
Well, so are you agreed to let it go at that?
I'm happy.
Uh-huh. Well, let's pursue the question of whether there is a dilution implicit in the new form of the Mass over against the Tridentine Mass. As you know, the Protestants have been arguing very heatedly on the various of revisions of the King James Bible, with one segment insisting that there is a theological dilution. Do you believe that there is in the new order?
I don't think so. Let's go back to one of the earlier things that Mr. Davies mentioned about the dilution of the sacrifice notion and the priesthood and so on. When the new missal of the Vatican II document, or the new missal of Paul VI came out, this was one of the criticisms. In the introduction to the ritual, or the introduction to the general instruction of the missal, very clear notion of how the sacrifice of the Mass is present in the new order of Mass, how the priesthood is very clearly there, how the priesthood of the layperson, different in essence from the priesthood of the ordained person, is still present there. The whole notion, the sense of the sacred, is in fact present. And I think the kind of sense that he said at the beginning, that the new Mass takes away from that, I don't think it's a delusion. I think it tries to bring that notion of the transcendent and the communitarian and bring it together. And the kind of abuses that he was talking about are abuses, but not the teaching of Vatican II. I don't see the new Mass as a dilution of what we had.
Do you have a comment on that?
Yeah, I certainly do. As Father says correctly, in the new missal, there's an introduction. There's a thing probably most people watching wouldn't know, called the general instruction to the new Roman missal. Well, when it came out, first of all, you just had the new order of Mass. You didn't have a complete missal with all the readings. You just had a new order of Mass, which had this general instruction with all the articles explaining it. Some of these articles, they were just totally Protestant. For instance, they explained the nature of the Mass, Article 7. They said it's the coming together of the people under the presidency of a priest, which is there's nothing formally heretical in it, but it's totally acceptable to Protestants. Article 48 said that during the Mass, it was the Last Supper was made present. That is heretical, actually. Well, when the missal which Father came out mentions with this foreword, that came out in 1970, and the foreword he has mentioned, the premium in Latin, as he said, it states every doctrine of the Council of Trent absolutely orthodox, in an orthodox manner, and says this is what the new Mass is intended to enshrine. But I think this foreword is the most damning indictment of the new Mass ever published. The fact that within a year of its publication, they had to put an introduction to it, saying, oh yes, well, it really is Catholic after all, it really is meant to show this. It's a far more damning indictment than anything traditionalists have written about it.
I'm not 100% sure I follow that. You say it's damning to reiterate the fact that it is dogmatically...
No, the fact that the new Mass was issued in 1969,
yeah,
and it evoked such criticism for its doctrinal inadequacy, which, if you like, I'll explain why it's doctrinally inadequate in a moment, that when it was republished in 1970, they had to add an introduction
to reiterate its orthodoxy.
Yes, protesting, affirming that it really was orthodox.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, now, do you think, is it your position, Father, that there actually was nothing in the new order of the Mass that surrendered any historic
I think there's a change of emphasis, and when the new Mass came out, there were persons who had difficulties because they used certain terms, or they didn't have the same emphasis as the previous Mass. And that document, however it was, why ever it was published, but clearly says, here it is, it's right there.
Oh, that's and in the second edition, there. Though, Father.
Well, it simply is an explanation because it's where it is, and it's very clearly right there.
Could I say a word about why I think it's inadequate?
Sure.
Yes. Well, now, if you... this book, this Liturgical Revolution trilogy I wrote, I was just intending to write one short thing about the new Mass, and I thought... I was doing a chapter about Cranmer's reform, and it was so interesting, so parallel, that in the end I ended up writing a whole book on that, so I'm pretty well up on that. And it is incredible the extent to which all the prayers and ceremonies which were removed from the Mass by the Protestants have been removed from the new one. For example, in the offertory was full of prayers mentioning sacrifice. There's one called Suscipe Sancte Pater, in which the priest says that he is there as the unworthy servant of God, offering a sacrifice for himself and for all here present. There's another one Father would be familiar with, the Placet Tibi, which came after the priest's communion. And virtually every mandatory prayer mentioning that the Mass is a sacrifice has been removed. There's nothing contrary to Catholic doctrine in the new Mass, but there was nothing contrary to Catholic doctrine in Cranmer's communion services. It's 1549 and 1552. And as a result of these changes, some Protestant sects now allow their members to take part in the Catholic Mass, and some are even willing to use it, which could never have happened with the Tridentine Mass.
What was it in the Tridentine Mass that would have offended a Protestant?
Well, the numerous specific references to sacrifice, stating that the Mass was a sacrifice offered to God, a propitiatory sacrifice, which could have an effect. You offer Mass for the sins of the living and the dead, which was anathema, because we'd get into deep water if we started on this, to the Protestant notion of grace. It all goes back to the difference between Catholic and Protestant notions of grace. But from the point of view of a Protestant, offering the Mass couldn't have any effect whatsoever. It's just a service at which you go and you remember what our Lord did for us, and you're grateful, and you drink bread, so you eat bread and you drink wine in his memory. And they're completely opposed to the Catholic doctrine of sacrifice. And as I'm sure Father knows, when they concocted this new Mass, they had six Protestant advisors who took a very active part in the deliberations. Sorry, I'm taking up too much time, but I'll give Father a turn.
You're doing fine.
One of the things that annoys me is there seems to have been so much dishonesty. Now, Archbishop Bunini, who was the chairman of the committee which concocted this new Mass, he was asked, did the Protestant advisers play an active part? And he put out a statement in his official magazine, Notizie. He said they were only once did they intervene, they were purely observers, and that's all. So I wrote to one of them. And he said, oh no, we played a very active part, and we were given all the documents the same as the Catholic observers. Every morning there was a discussion, a great free-for-all, in which we put forward our opinions. And that sort of thing has happened again and again.
Well, let me ask you this then, Father. Do you find that there have been significant strides in the direction of a desirable ecumenism since Vatican II?
Oh, surely, I think so. And I think you could take look at things two different ways. You can say the new Mass obviously is bad because Protestants find it acceptable. Mm-hmm. And you could say that's a bad thing. Or you can say, is it a bad thing now that Catholics are much more biblically oriented? Is it a bad thing now that the treasures of the Scriptures are open more richly to Catholics? Is it a bad thing now that Catholics at a wedding ceremony, almost all Catholics who are married today, would be reading 28 scriptural passages before they prepare their marriage, their own marriage vows? Would that be a bad thing because Protestants were biblical people? And now that we have discovered that we were not enough biblical people as Catholics, is that a bad thing? Oh, there's not everything Protestant isn't bad. And I think to say the new Mass is bad because Protestants like the new Mass is I don't think is a logical kind of step. So that I think the Church is saying that there's kind of a coming together, that we had the sacrifice and that sacrifice element is still there, but we had minimized the community concept of the Mass, and the Church is trying to bring that.
Well, presumably the Protestants would prefer Catholicism if we did away with the Pope.
So are you going to do away with the Pope?
Well, I wouldn't, but I suppose some people would. Hans Kung probably would. The There is a question of definition, right? The ideal of ecumenism, as I understand it, was to discover in various Christian denominations, to stress that which was similar and stress less that which was dissimilar for the purpose of common action, to the extent the common action, that it was relevant to have Christian impetus, impulse. Now, do you find that the steps being taken by the present pope are an affront to the spirit of ecumenism? For instance, his actions in Germany and Holland.
Well, I think I don't think I would accept your definition of ecumenism as merely to accentuate the positive and minimize the negative. I think it's the goal of ecumenism is the goal of Jesus, that we be one.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in that process, first we try to discover what the other person believes. Mm-hmm. What are the truths of the other person's faith, or what do they really believe, or what do they practice? And then it's to try to find out what common elements are present there from the Spirit. I think the biblical emphasis in Protestantism is something we really needed to discover and to rediscover or reintroduce into Roman Catholic life. I think it's very clear that most Protestant churches are becoming much more ritualistic in their worship, are going back in our direction as far as ritual is concerned, that you see a fusing together. So there is a popular kind of ecumenism to emphasize the elements that we share, and to minimize those that are dissimilar. I think that's also a good practical way of doing things. But there reaches a point where we have to say, this is where I am, and this is where you are. And I think the Holy Father today is kind of clearly saying it's time not just to have a folksy ecumenism, but this is what it is to be Catholic. And I think we'd probably be very acceptable on that. I think you're very happy with the statements he's making.
I'm very pleased with these statements, the Pope's, and I'd agree to a certain extent with Father there. Obviously, the more Catholics know about the Bible, the better. Well, actually, soon after I became a Catholic, when I came into the army, I went to a Catholic college, and then I started teaching a Catholic school. I was quite shocked, having been brought up as a Protestant, to find that none of my pupils had Bibles. So the first thing I did was bought every pupil a Bible. But there's a difference between encouraging Catholics to have a more profound knowledge of the Bible and removing from the Mass prayers which are likely to offend Protestants. You see, the essence of all this is the truth. Is something true or is it not true? And if it's true that the Mass is a sacrifice, if it's true, Catholics believe that our Lord founded a church, which is a visible church, a hierarchical church, with the Pope teaching infallibly on matters of faith and order and morals, and that he requires everyone to belong to that church. Now, if that is so, one is doing a disservice to Protestants by minimizing the aspects of Catholic dogma that are unacceptable to them, to give them the impression that really we all believe the same thing. We've had some things, I won't go into this much, but I don't know if anyone in America has heard of them, but we have a thing called the Anglican Roman Catholic International Commission, which probably Father has heard of, where they've purport to produced agreed statements on the ministry, the Eucharist, and papal infallibility. And what they do, they produce a statement on the Eucharist in which there's nothing to which a Protestant could object, and the same on the priesthood. Well, on that basis, you could Catholics could produce an agreed statement with Unitarians on God, in which nothing to offend Unitarians would be there, but I don't think that's honest. And that's what's behind the entire position of Archbishop Lefebvre. He says, is this true or is it not true? And if it's true, he's going to adhere to it. And if it isn't true, then the Catholic Church has been wrong for 2,000 years.
I think behind this is a problem I have in two areas. It surfaced as I read the book, that explanation, as you called it, not a defense, but an explanation,
yes,
of Archbishop. And it comes over to the liturgy situation. Having worked for 3 years with the bishops when this was beginning to develop, the kind of Mass we have today, even the translations, which I know you have some difficulties with, and I have some difficulties with, to say, as you did at one point, that the Constitutional Liturgy, part of it was heretical, I think Article 7, to say this statement or that statement.
Article 48, I said was heretical.
Okay. But you also have problems with number 7.
Number 7, I said it was ambiguous.
Okay, all right. To say that that's heretical after all the bishops together, working with the Holy Father, a commission under the Holy Father's direction of scholars, not just six Protestant scholars, but about 70 Catholic scholars throughout the world, carefully researched, examined, and published this reticle. I have problems with that. And I think the key thing I found in that book, and this comes through the whole sense here, the idea of not accepting the Holy Father's authority. A friend of mine said yesterday, we were talking about this, when you reject papal authority, you replace it with individual infallibility. When you reject papal authority, you replace it with personal infallibility. And that was a difficulty. Who is the judge of what's heretical in tradition? In this book, Archbishop says, I am the judge. And when we're back to my tradition, then I'll accept the Holy Father. I think that's a fatal difficulty.
Yeah, it's obviously a logical dilemma, which he attempts to explain by insisting that the purpose of fidelity was in order to guard the faith. But when behavior is not contumacious, if the inclination is spiritual. But I grant he has a very considerable difficulty, which I think you acknowledge.
No, I find this enthusiasm for papal authority, which Father's evincing here, very interesting for, shall we say, a liturgical spokesman of the American hierarchy.
No. That you dignify me. I'm not a liturgical spokesman. I'm a parish priest who works with
people.
I'll
reduce you to the ranks.
That's all right, thank you. I'm better now.
You see, that is another thing which annoys traditionists, is this complete set of double standards in the church, one for dealing with people like us and one for dealing with people like yourself. And I'll give you an example, this question of communion under both kinds. The Vatican has a set of circumstances set down under which you're allowed to have communion under both kinds. They said that bishops can choose extra circumstances relating to their own particular country, but these are only to be for particular groups on specific occasions, never to be when there's a large number of the faithful present. And each occasion must be regulated. I've got the text here if you'd like me to read it. Your bishops introduced communion in the communion under both kinds. They told your people in America, we don't need to ask permission from the Vatican because the Vatican has allowed it here, which is totally untrue. So they virtually, that was a schismatic act. They took it upon themselves to introduce their own rules for America in complete disobedience to the Holy See. And that your spokesman, Bishop Kelly, I think you have, has admitted that the Vatican didn't give them permission. And I've checked up on that myself, and they're very, very displeased about this in the Vatican. So you see, and again with communion in the hand. Communion in the hand was forbidden. It was tolerated. People started doing it. Your bishops didn't come down on the people who were having communion in the hand. And then it was legalized. So it would impress me much more, this talk about obedience, if it was accepted generally as a principle. But obedience is only called for if it's from people who are trying to uphold the traditional faith.
Well, let's hear from Dr. Malachi Martin. Dr. Martin was a Jesuit priest, a professor at the Pontifical Biblical Institute of Rome, a scholar of the Dead Sea Scrolls. he has a doctorate in Semitic languages, studied at Oxford in Hebrew, served under Pope John, and as an associate of Cardinal Bayer, and the author of numerous books, and he has a new book coming out in this fall called The King of Kings on King David. Dr. Martin.
Monsignor and Michael, before we get on to some other meaty subjects, there's something which I don't think either of you focused on, namely concerning Marcel Lefebvre. You know, I really will ask both of you to say something about it from your different points of view, if your points of view are different. The bull, I'm sure I'm going to quote it wrong, the papal bull, which is quo prima, Michael, is that what it's called? Which was supposed to have perpetual validity, in virtue of which Archbishop Lefebvre continues to promote the Latin liturgy. I hesitate to call it the Tridentine liturgy, although we all do, because it's far older than the Tridentine. It goes back to Pope Damasus, really, except in a few essentials. What do you both say about that? Michael, you'd want to explain briefly, I suppose, because you probably have more near your mind. And then I'd ask Monsignor to say a word about it, because if that quo primum holds, let me put an objection to both of you, therefore. Monsignor, if that quo primum holds, Marcel Lefebvre is relying on a privilege conferred by Pius V, I think, perpetually, that no pope can take away. If, on the other hand, as they say in the Latin, it hasn't been abrogated, but abrogated, then Marcel Lefebvre has a difficulty. I think we should deal with that before we go on to something else.
It's
the spine of the Lefebvre stance in propagating the Latin liturgy, which I love, by the way.
Well, it's not too tough, really. Well, as Dr. Martin has mentioned, when the... I was glad he made that point, that, by the way. When people say the Tridentine Mass, it's somewhat of a misnomer, because the... In all its essence, the Tridentine Mass goes back right to the time of Gregory the Great. And an argument that's frequently brought up, people say, well, if St. Pius V in 1570 could have a new Mass, why shouldn't Paul VI? But all St. Pius V did was to codify the liturgy that was then existing, that had evolved by a natural process over a period of 1,000 years. There's never been anything in the history of the Church like this, where you get a committee together and say, let's make up a Mass. This hasn't been done before. But as Dr. Martin says, it was promulgated with a bull quo primum, which said that every priest would have the right to celebrate this Mass in perpetuity. But again, as he mentioned, it can be argued that this bull has been, again, it gets terribly complicated here, abrogated by the new legislation issued by Paul VI. Abrogated means being replaced by new legislation. But one doesn't really need to spend too much time on this, because there is another right, a right of immemorial custom. If a liturgy is over 200 years old, you have a priest has a right to celebrate it from immemorial custom, unless the Pope specifically forbids it. So it's a case of what we say in England, heads I win, tails you lose on this, because if quo primum hasn't been abrogated, we can still celebrate it because of the privilege in quo primum. But if quo primum has been abrogated, priests can still celebrate it from the right of immemorial custom.
Has it been abrogated?
I'm not a canon lawyer. I wouldn't like to comment on it. There is an excellent study on this by a professor, Neri Capponi, who's the professor of canon law in the University of Florence.
He says, no, it has not been.
He says it's an open question, but he said what I said. In any case, it's irrelevant, because the priest has the right from immemorial custom.
Yes. All right. Monsignor, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I'd like to. You said you like the Latin Mass, right?
Fine.
That's okay.
I was reared in
the
Latin
Mass. I just want to make
Mass.
It very clear that we're not talking about Latin or English Mass. We're talking about the form of the Mass. And as the Holy Father made a statement in this document on the Eucharist and Holy Thursday, that we should be more sensitive to those who would like to have Latin Masses. I'd just like to make that point. But it should be in the form of the Mass approved by Paul VI.
Yes.
VI is pretty clear about
it. He not only said we should be... he said, actually, I'm quoting the Pope,
yes,
in
fine,
that... He said, it is therefore necessary to show not only understanding, but also full respect. I wish the bishops in our country did. Monsignor, I have a question for you.
I'd like to just come back to the other that the Holy Father, in his document, Introduction to the Missal,
yes,
and in his correspondence with Bishop Archbishop Lefebvre in the book,
yes,
very clear that what quo primum did,
yes,
did not lock it forever, that it was taken in a particular context, and that this replaces that.
Yes. Okay. It is a... Michael, actually, I want to change my mind. I want to get to you first, if I may.
Okay.
I want to take the entire question of Marcel Lefebvre and his traditionalist stand, and my sympathy for that is terribly deep, I assure you. By the way, when I say I liked the Latin Mass, I meant I liked everything about it, the liturgy of the prayers. And I want to take the Cologne incident and to put the following question on a broad scope with you. You would admit, I think, that a validly ordained priest today, using the Pauline Mass with the correct intention and the apt matter, bread, wine, according to the laws of the Church, says a valid Mass, and consecrates and really does represent the sacrifice of Jesus on Calvary. Okay?
Yes, and the Archbishop's just put out a statement affirming that's his opinion,
okay,
too.
He did. I read that statement. Now, wouldn't it be far better, therefore, while satisfying the, as the Pope says, satisfying those who like the old liturgy, to say this is not only a very different world, and not only a beleaguered world where Christians are in a vast minority and an increasing minority, but it's also a world which, as far as we can see, within the lifetime of our grandchildren, if God has blessed us with grandchildren, the majority of mankind will be black and yellow, not white. And we'll not have Western culture. They may have the American bubble of dishwashers, und so weiter und so was, but they won't have the white mentality. Now, Latin and the entire Latin liturgy was developed by a Mediterranean, within the Mediterranean area, with a Latinate culture, culturally going back to Greek and Greeks and Rome, which, however much we studied, will not last and will not be practiced in Katanga or in Shillong. And therefore, that the broad view would say, conserve, keep our rites and rituals, but the church in venturing on this very dangerous road, and I have some strictures against you, Monsignor, there in a moment, if I can get back to it, in all charity, because I found you wishy-washy about that renewal. Oh, Michael, I found you wishy-washy on things, too. I want to get at you. But don't you think this is a new venture for the church, as they did with the Lombards, whom they called that loathsome people, but in the time of Gregory and his successor? We're endeavoring, while not crunching the sentiments of those who like the Latin, to widen the scope of this church which Jesus said finally must be preached to all nations and must not be confined to a Latinate mentality. I'm advocating as the devil.
How do you handle that?
Well, to start with that, I don't go a lot on this cultural change thing which you just mentioned and that Father mentioned earlier, because if you're familiar with European history, American history, when you think what's happened in the last few hundred, the Industrial Revolution, the two world wars, those were far greater shocks than anything that's happened since the 1960s when you had Vatican II. There's nothing much changed in Western society since then. Yeah. And obviously what I'm principally concerned with is the faith within the society in which I live. I don't really want to speculate on what's going to happen in 100 years' time in a predominantly black or yellow culture. Yeah. I'd like to see, you're saying about this being that it would be a good thing to adapt it to the cultures of people, but when St. Augustine came over to the Saxons, who are really dreadful Germanic, as pointed out, I'm Welsh, nothing to do with the horrible Saxons in English, but when he came over there, the English were able to adapt the Latin liturgy, and I think if they could, anybody could. When they went to India, I have a lot of correspondence with India now. Now, terrible things are happening over there. Theoretically, it's called the Indianization of the liturgy, but it's really the Hinduization, and they're turning it into a Hindu service.
It's dreadful.
Indian Catholics are indignant about this.
I know, it's a dreadful mishmash. Monsignor, though, on the other hand, you're not really full of defense today, because on the one hand, you seem to draw, perhaps you didn't mean it, a parallel between Hans Küng and Lefebvre, which I find very unjustified. After all, Hans Küng is a declared heretic in the sense that he has professed heresy, he's denied the divinity of Jesus, doesn't believe he rose from the dead, doesn't believe you and I will rise from the dead, doesn't believe in the Immaculate Conception or the infallibility, doesn't believe there's such a thing as sacred orders for a priest. In fact, you know. And Lefebvre has never done all of that. Now, you make a radical distinction, don't you, between Lefebvre and Hans Küng?
I'd make a distinction. Go ahead.
Not a radical one? Not really a radical one? If so, wouldn't you really say Lefebvre was guilty of material heresy? Would your stricture go as far as that?
No, I don't. No, I wouldn't say that.
You wouldn't say that?
No.
That's rather a radical difference, Monsignor.
Okay.
Isn't it?
All right.
Now, as regards the renewal,
yes.
You refuse to establish any correlation between the proposed renewal of the Vatican Council
yes.
and what I think, honestly, is a decadence that has set in. At least a lot of people think so.
Mm.
Is there any correlation, or is it just causal, or casual, occasional?
I think the causes for deterioration are just too enormous to pinpoint them on a ritual change or change in structures of the church. Because we have parish councils or synods or whatever,
yes.
or consultation, and a new liturgy in a different language, to say that's the cause, I just don't think that's possible.
Well,
and I don't think we could say, I don't think the church is such a bad situation as we would hear, a deterioration, degradation, so on. We have enormous problems in the church. But I also, as a parish priest, see enormously good things happening in terms of lay people being involved in the church and exercising ministries that are valuable and have been untapped.
Well, still in all, Bill, when you were talking, you described your reactions as a practicing Catholic, listening to the liturgy as such. I'm sure you weren't just saying that because you like Latin or something like that. Have you the sense that there has been a general deterioration of the Catholic spirit as such, and the substitution of something of a more ecumenical and Christian?
Yes, it's it seems to me that the emphasis has been communitarian, and there's something about Latin which it seems to me gave you a sense of privacy. There is the Mass is a mystery. Supernatural, the supernatural is a mystery. The church is founded on certain mysteries, and there's a sense in which it is, I think, culturally consistent that a special vocabulary should be used in describing or in engaging in such a liturgy. So that I think that Latin had going for it not only that it was traditional and universal, but also precisely that it was not vernacular, in the same sense in which I object to I object to the elimination of the vocative thee and thou, substituting you. It seems to me that that is an informalization of a subject which should continue to be dealt with rather formally.
Well, let me take one sector of what you just said. When you were being educated, you know, in your young days, was there a stress on what we've been calling here the communitarian? Did that ever come up?
No, there were only a few prayers even said jointly, and that was at the very end of the Mass. Now you're praying jointly half the time.
Most of the time, if you're praying at all, and not being annoyed. That I'm betraying my prejudice there. Mm-hmm. But in your concept of the history of the Church as such, was this communitarian idea a very prevalent idea in the past? Well, was it lost along the way?
I think it's unquestionably true that the Mass of the catacombs put together the believers in a sense of fraternity, that they felt a bond that people tend to feel when they are being oppressed, the same kind of bond that gives that special exuberance to Roman Catholicism in Eastern Europe. I think that's unquestionably true. But there evolved then, I think, an ontological approach to the sacrifice of the Mass, which has been around for a long time. Evelyn Waugh handled the problem, I think, rather adroitly when, in his letter to the London Times, in which he said, there are those who say that the Latin Mass is only for the educated few, but surely Mother Church and all her charity can make a little nook even for the educated few. Now, this is, of course, even more than it is Catholic doctrine.
Yes.
Still, I think that in that letter and in other pronouncements, he identified himself with a continuum, which to be sure was affected in church history by the fact that the church was anything but an established religion for several hundred years.
Have I time for another question to your guest,
Bill?
You have
4 minutes.
4 minutes. Well, if I could give one question, which probably will interest you, especially because it concerns something that both were talking about. This introduction that was written by Paul VI to his first edition of the Ordo, was it? Am I correct in saying that?
Well, it wasn't written by Paul VI.
No, but he published it.
It was published with his authority.
That first introduction, and then, as I understand it, Cardinals Baccini Ottaviani wrote a rather private letter to Paul VI about it, complaining that it had departed from the Catholic faith. It was withdrawn in the sense that he republished, and correct me if I'm wrong now, by the way, I'm trying to get the facts straight, first of all, he republished the introduction in which it was redone, and those elements of the old Catholic Mass were reiterated. Now, when you were both talking about it, Monsignor said that it was a change of emphasis. Monsignor, as I understood, I read them both about 3 years ago, so I'm vague on it, but it's a very important point. As far as I know, there was no mention of the sacrifice of Calvary and sacrifice of the Mass and the action of the priest as representing Jesus at all in that first introduction. It was more a precedency of an assembly of people gathered to memorialize a past event, like, say, the Seder memorializes the passage through the Red Sea. That's my impression. I don't know what you think about that, Michael Davies.
One point I'd better stress, it was the introduction to the general instruction to the new Mass was changed. Mm. Nothing was changed in the new Mass itself. All the deficiencies which I've mentioned in the new Mass, they still remain. It was only the theoretical...
It was an attempt to baptize it.
Yes, right? It was an attempt to baptize it, or to what I believe you'd call in America a cover-up.
Michael, that's a different thing.
Yes, it's a different thing, is it? No, sorry. Well,
we know all about cover-ups.
That's an impeachable offense.
Yes, put my British foot in it.
You won't be, yes. No, you won't be impeached for baptizing, no. But you will be impeached for covering up in this country.
Oh.
Yes, Monsignor, I'd like you to.
The order of the Mass was not changed in that second edition.
Yeah.
The general instruction of the Roman Missal, which gives the 8-chapter guidelines for the celebration, it was not changed, except in a few very minor ways. But there was an added introduction that simply explained how in the order of the Mass and in the instruction, those elements that some said were missing are in fact there, and it cites illustrations of that. And the point you mentioned about the sacrifice of the priest would be important.
I'm sorry to have to contradict you there, Father, but there were a number of very, very important changes made in the general introduction itself. You did say just now I was rather naughty for saying Article 48 taught heresy. In the first edition it said that Last Supper was made present. In the second edition it's changed to say the sacrifice of the Mass is made, the sacrifice of the cross is made present. In Article 7 then now mentions the sacrifice and the priest acting in persona Christi. I've got a whole chapter on this in this book I've done, Pope Paul's New Mass, all the changes that were made. But even that doesn't satisfy me because it's the New Mass itself wasn't improved.
Thank you very much, Mr. Davies, and thank you very much, Father Champlin, and thank you, Dr. Malachi Martin. Gentlemen, thank you.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations. Thank you.